Here at Geisinger, we are always prioritizing the full 24 hours because it's important not only to you, it's important to us. In order for us to achieve the best outcomes for you together, we need to make sure we're taking into account all of your hours. As a pediatric neurologist, I very frequently am focusing on sleep as a tool for learning and your best academic outcomes. However, sleep as a tool in terms of your cognition doesn't stop once you graduate high school. So today we're going to talk about sleep and aging brain in regards to the offerings we have at 65 Forward. So one of the things that I would anticipate you're seeing commonly at 65 Forward, maybe people coming in and saying, you know, I just don't feel as sharp as I used to. I feel like I'm forgetting things. I feel like I'm having a challenge with word finding or whatever it might be in terms of how they frame. When you're seeing patients who have those type of cognitive concerns, what are some of the approaches or some of the questions that you may be asking or are still struggling to be able to say, I'm not quite certain as to how to best approach a certain area?
Yeah, cognitive decline is certainly something we see very frequently as we are dealing with an older population of patients. It is certainly on a spectrum from mild, moderate to more complex. But one of the areas that I'm hearing today is I'm wondering if I'm not assessing sleep enough as part of that cognitive decline. And I'm wondering what you could offer us in primary care to start making sure we're incorporating questions around sleep and sleep hygiene or just good sleep in general.
Sure.
What's appropriate? What, you know, daytime naps, are they still okay? Are those things that I should be guiding folks on in addition to that workup for that furthering cognitive decline?
Sure, so you're correct in that when we're looking at cognitive decline, that there's so many medical things that we also have to make sure that we're keeping track of. However, sleep is completely pivotal to the optimal brain performance, and it also can be a tool of preventing further decline. What do I mean by that? Well, we know that sleep is so crucial in terms of the learning process. So as a pediatric neurologist, very frequently we're talking about the learning process in terms of acquisition, consolidation, retrieval. Acquisition and retrieval occurs on a day-to-day basis when I'm awake. I'm acquiring new knowledge and I'm retrieving it and telling you it back. Consolidation is occurring at night and it's occurring during sleep. Some of the things that we've learned at this point is that there have been numerous sleep disorders that have been identified to be directionally related and even causative for progressive cognitive impairment. So there are some where it's a reversible cognitive issue related to sleep. So if you think about when you were a resident and the nights that you were on night float or taking call, I'm sure that your cognitive performance wasn't as good the following day. And that's mainly because our attention becomes impaired. Mm-hmm. And when our attention becomes impaired, many times we're also having difficulties in recalling. Mm-hmm. It also will make us more impulsive. So it's more likely to select the wrong words or the wrong thing. So always looking at, are there any acute changes that are occurring in my sleep that is causing me to have this acute neurocognitive decline? The second piece is that any person who's complaining of cognitive issues, we should always be looking at their sleep. Why is that? Studies have looked at when we are getting inappropriate duration, quality, or timing of sleep, it actually can lead to a more progressive deterioration. So for instance, individuals who are susceptible to Alzheimer's disease due to a genetic predisposition, when they have mild cognitive impairment, so the early stages of cognitive difficulties, if there's the presence of something like obstructive sleep apnea, when we've analyzed those patients who are treated successfully with CPAP versus no CPAP, those who are treated with CPAP have a slower deterioration in their cognitives, where we see those who were not treated have a worsening. And so many times people will ask, what is the cause and effect there? Is it just that they're not getting the right quality of sleep? Well, unfortunately, when we are having this dysfunction of sleep, sleep is another neurologic process.
Yeah.
And so it actually is creating biologic changes which make a greater accumulation of some of those things that we want to get rid of to prevent some of those blockages in how our brain is actually able to process those signals. So I love the fact that you've already been thinking about it, of how do I utilize this as a tool and what other questions do we want to ask? I always tell people, keep it simple. Ask about duration, ask about quality, ask about the timing and regularity of their sleep and whether or not they have complaints about that daytime performance or wakefulness. If we're identifying those things, I generally will then ask them to keep some sort of symptom diary so that we're better able to direct them to the right care. Very frequently, we see a reflex of it's insomnia or it's sleep apnea. With over 70 different types of sleep disorders, we want to make sure we're treating the right one. And in fact, many people who have one sleep disorder very commonly have two to three. And so therefore, we want to make sure we're taking that same comprehensive approach at night as we are during the day.
Wonderful. Thank you.